hear a word from the Lord, get your phone, your iPad, your notepad and pen, and of course, old school, your Bible. Let's sit back, relax, as we dig into the Word of God. Yes, there is a word from the Lord.
Well, hello everybody, and welcome once again to this special time in God's Word. I'm Dr. Sheldon D. Newton, coming to you from Jesus Christ Centered Ministries International, located right here in beautiful Nassau, Bahamas. We're so glad to have you with us. We want to welcome Jesus Christ Centered Ministries International members and partners. Hey, you're helping to make it happen as we take God's Word to the world. We also want to welcome all of you in the family islands of the Bahamas, the Caribbean, all over in America, Israel, China, Egypt, Venezuela, wherever you're from, England, Europe, wherever you're listening, we thank God for you and we're glad to have you with us. Shall we pray? Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for your word. We ask you to open your word to our hearts. Prepare us in these last days for the outpouring of the mighty Holy Spirit in a way that we, Father, have not yet experienced, in a way that is grand and glorious. And prepare us for the coming of our Lord and our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ from heaven. We give you thanks and praise for it now. In Jesus' name, amen. We have been studying the subject, if you remember, of knowing what the church ought to be doing in these last days. We have been looking at this from several angles. We found out the signs of the times are all around us on a consistent basis. And we found out that Jesus told us in Matthew 24 concerning watching out for deception in these last days. We found out concerning what Paul had to say, some of the things he said regarding the last days. And now we are looking at messages that Jesus gave to the Apostle John in the book of Revelation, which were messages, I believe, for all churches of all time, because there's only one body of Christ. And whatever the Master had to say to one church, he says to all churches that fit within that particular situation or circumstance. This is why we can still read the letters from the church to the churches of Ephesus, letters to the churches at Colossae, or the church at Colossae, letters to the church at Ephesus, letters to the churches of Galatia. This is why we can still read these letters and receive instruction, information, revelation, and doctrine from these letters, because what the Master had to say to one part of the church, he says to all churches, his messages still ring true to all believers everywhere if we fit or fall into the particular categories as to what he had to say. And so when we studied the book of Revelation, we found out already in chapters 1 that the Master himself gave us the three different timelines, or the three different parts that the book of Revelation falls in. And he said in chapter 1, I believe it's verse 19, he said, told John, he said, write the things which you have seen, which was the vision of the glorified Christ, and the vision of the glorified Christ standing in the midst of the candlesticks, holding the seven stars in his hands. He said, and then write the things which are. And the things which are was concerning his messages to the seven churches. That's what those seven golden candlesticks represented. They represented the churches, and they still represent the church. Each church that bears the name of Christ is a golden candlestick that is supposed to be shining as a light in this dark world to show people the way, to show people that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, you see? And so he held the stars, you remember, in his right hand, and according to the messages given to the churches, these stars represented the messengers of the seven churches, or we would say in our day, the pastors, the local shepherds, the leaders of the local churches, all right? And so he's speaking through, giving these messages to the Apostle John, and he's talking to those pastors, and by extension, to all pastors, and he's giving a direct word concerning things that were going on in those churches, and things that needed to be corrected in some of those churches, He gives us encouragement. He gives us consolation. He gives us the understanding that in suffering for him, there are rewards. And he gives us rebuke and correction if it is needed. And so we see here that the Word of God, just like Paul said, by the Spirit of God, 2 Timothy 3:16-17, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, and instruction in righteousness. And that's what the Master does in these letters written to the churches. Now, we've already covered the first church here in the book of Revelation chapter 2, which is the church at Ephesus. And you remember the one correction he had to make with them was concerning that they had left their first love. We have dealt with that already, and we encourage you, if you've not heard that, go back and look at some of the other videos we have on YouTube, and you'll be able to locate that that message. Then we talked concerning his message to the church, and I want to emphasize something here in just a moment, but we talked concerning his message to the church at Smyrna. Now, in the message at the church at Ephesus, he did talk to them concerning how the fact that they hated the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which he also hated, and we said we'll get to that. And then he talks about the reward given to those who have ear to hear, who would listen and obey him. And one of those rewards is immortality, that we would receive our glorified bodies and live in an immortal body that will never die. Praise the name of the Lord. Now, with the angel or the pastor of the church in Smyrna, to the angel of the church in Smyrna, right? And we already covered this. And this particular church dealt with those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, persecuted for their stand for Christ. Now, here's what I wanted to say. And this was on my mind. You may have seen that I kind of hesitated because I wanted to make sure and make this point. These are seven churches that the Master addresses. Out of all seven of these churches, only two were not reprimanded by the Master. Only two of them. Now that is very, very interesting. Out of all seven of these churches, only two were praised and commended and not reprimanded by the Master. That is so interesting. And Smyrna is one of those churches. What was his instruction to them? Fear not none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison. You may be tried, and you shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. He that had an ear, let him hear, verse 11, what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death. Now, before we go into the third church, go over, please, to the book of Revelation chapter 20, and let me show you what the second death is. We don't have to try and speculate what the second death is. That's one of the great things in studying the book of Revelation. If you take the time to read through it without preconceived ideas, the book actually interprets itself. I mean, whatever he says in one part, if you just read long enough, you'll see where he explains it further down, you see? And so in the book of Revelation, chapter number 20, notice here in verse, let me start here at verse number 11 for context. He said, and I saw a great white throne and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. And books were open, and another book was open, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books, according to their works. Now watch this. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they would judge every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. So what is the second death? Being cast into the lake of fire. Let me give you one more proof of that. Revelation 21, verse number 8. But the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. So then the master was speaking here to the church in Smyrna and said, the person that that here had an ear to hear, and here's what the Spirit says, and that overcomes, meaning they stand for the Lord to the end. When he says here that they will not be heard of the second death, it means that they will escape or not go to the lake of fire. They will not be thrown into the lake of fire to burn. My brothers and sisters, I know that this is a time when many people don't hear much messages concerning there being a hell. But there is a hell. There is a place of eternal punishment for those who do not live under the Lordship of Jesus Christ. And whether we want to preach that or not, it's in the Bible. And it will come to pass. Those who refuse God's gift of eternal life, those who refuse to live under the Lordship of Jesus Christ, will be thrown into the lake that burns with fire and brimstone. There is a judgment coming. There is that great white throne judgment coming. And the wicked shall not prosper forever. The Bible says the wicked shall be turned into hell, and all the nations that forget God. And I hope that you hear me. If you don't know Jesus as your Lord and your Savior, this is the time when you need to make him your Lord. This is the time when you need to give your life to Jesus. And stop playing these games like you're going to do whatever you want and live however you want. And your life is your life and you're going to live it how you want to live it. Listen to me. At the end of it all, you will stand before God. You will be judged on the basis of what you did with his son. And if you haven't given your life to his son and lived under his lordship, you will be turned into hell. The Bible teaches it. We cannot go against what the Word of God says, because the Word of God is ultimate truth. There is no truth that is more sure than the Word of God. Amen. Heaven and earth will pass away. This Word will stand forever. So there is a heaven to gain and a hell to shun. And if you don't give your life to Christ and live under his lordship and live under his lordship to the end, you will end up in a place call hell, the lake of fire. So I encourage you, my brothers and sisters, to make your calling and your election sure. Now notice the third church here in the book of Revelation chapter 12. And to the angel of the church in Pergamos write, these things saith he, Jesus, which had the sharp sword with two edges. I know thy works. He keeps telling them that. I know what you're doing. I know thy works, and where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is. Now, that's a very interesting term. We'll talk about that in a moment. And thou holdest fast my name, and hast not denied my faith, even in those days wherein Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you where Satan dwelleth. But I have a few things against thee. Now let's back up here a minute. What did the master mean when he said, even where Satan, you dwell in where Satan's throne is, or Satan's seat is? We have to understand that there are satanic and demonic spirits all around us. Satan is a real being. He was created by God, and he fell. He chose to go against God. He's a fallen angel, and he had other angels. He had deceived or duped other angels into working with him against God. Well, Satan has set up a system or a kingdom that tries to run the affairs of what is going on in the world. The Bible actually calls him in 2 Corinthians 4:4, the God of this world, meaning of this world system. The system that this world operates under is a satanic system. And if you notice, it is set up in such a way that it's an unfair, very wicked, very evil system. It's not a godly system, what's going on in the earth right now at all. In the world system, the Bible says the whole world lieth in evil or wickedness, you know. Or one translation says the whole world, in this 1 John chapter 5, the whole world lies under the control of the evil one. That's what the Bible says, the whole world. If you read again, you'll find out where Satan has been called the prince of the power of the air. You'll read where the Bible says in Ephesians 6:12, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world. Watch this, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Now, other translation says against wicked spirits in the heavenlies. Wicked spirits in the heavenlies. You see, there are three heavens. And Paul said that in the book of 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter. He talked about being caught up to the third heaven. So there are three heavens, you see. Now someone say, well, and if you don't see me in the third one, go up to the fourth one. And if you don't see me in the fourth one, go up to the fifth one. My brothers and sisters, the Bible says there are three. So where are you going with four and five, all right? So there are three heavens. Right above us, there's this atmospheric heaven. And then right above that, there is the stellar heavens. That's where the moon and the stars and the sun and so forth is. And then beyond that, there is the third heaven where the throne of God is, you see? So now Satan dwells in the heavenlies. He operates in this atmosphere and out there even somewhat where the stars and so forth are, all right? And what he does is he, through his demonic forces, he actually tries to manipulate and influence people and manipulate and influence governments to do his will, to do what he wants them to do, and to go in a way that's contrary to the ways of God. Now, I don't need to try and prove that point to you. I mean, all you have to do is look at the way governments operate in the world, and you will see it is not a godly system at all. A whole lot of it is a demonic system. It's obvious they're being controlled by somebody who they probably don't even realize they're being controlled by. Even though we don't know who the Antichrist as a person is yet, that spirit of the Antichrist has been operating in this earth for some time, you see? And the devil is the one running world empires and running world governments and so forth and manipulating things to go in a way to keep men blinded by something called pleasure. The love of money, pleasure, and so forth. It's the same things that the devil offered Jesus in the temptation when he said, if you bow down and worship me, I'll give you. He showed him the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them, if you remember in Luke chapter 4. And the Bible says, he told Jesus, he said, if you bow down and worship me, he said, I'll give you all of this. You see? And Jesus didn't say, oh, Satan, it ain't yours to begin with. No, Jesus just said, it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Well, how could Satan say, if you bow down and worship me, I'll give you the glory? He didn't say, I'll give you the earth. He said, he showed him the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them, you see? He showed him the systems that he had set up, the evil systems, what he's running the world through, what he's running mankind through, the evil governmental systems, the evil lustful systems, the evil monetary way of dealing, of doing business, or the wickedness and evil in this world where people think, oh, I can have whatever I want, and don't realize that there are going to be consequences that go with that, you see? And he was offering Jesus all of the wickedness and the evil things, but what is actually shrouded in something called pleasure, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, those kind of things, you see? He was offering all this to the Lord Jesus, and Satan said, he said he would have given it to him because it had been being delivered to him. It had been delivered to the devil. Well, who delivered it to the devil? Adam did, when Adam sinned. You see, Adam was really, in a sense, the god of this world. God had given the dominion in the earth to man. He had given the dominion in the earth to Adam. And Adam, through sinning, gave it away to Satan. In other words, when he sinned, and the Bible says, whoever you yield yourself to, they become your master, you see? And so, because they yielded to the devil, they became children of the devil. And now the devil had a way to work through them to try and set up what he wanted set up, which was a system and kingdoms that were against God. All right? And so if you read even when it came to the killing of Abel, it talk about how in the book of 1 John, it said Cain was of that wicked one and slew his brother. Why? Because Satan, from the time Adam sinned and yielded to the devil in temptation, from the time of that sin, Satan was now able to work through man to accomplish his evil purposes, you see? And he's been doing that from that time straight up to now. And will continue doing that until the Lord Jesus Christ finally comes and put a total stop to the enemy system and cast the devil into the lake of fire. Now, some people say, oh, but Satan is in hell. No, he's not. He's never been in hell. He's scared of hell too. He's more afraid of hell than people are because he knows it's real. He knows it's real, you see? And he fears hell. He's scared of hell. The Bible says the devils believe there's one God and they tremble, you see? But he's on the earth. He was cast to the earth. He's in the atmosphere of the earth. When Job, you remember the book of Job, when Satan went before the throne of God and God asked him, where you came from? He said, from walking to and fro in the earth. He's in the atmosphere of this earth, you see? And he would set up, he's not omnipresent. Satan is not everywhere, okay? All right? He's not that bad. No, he's not omnipresent. There's only one true God, all right? So Satan is a fallen angel. And so he would set up his kingdom or his so-called throne in different places at different times to accomplish his evil purposes. Well, at this particular time, he had his throne set up over Pergamos, you see, and he was trying to accomplish his evil purposes there. And you can tell that he was operating. He even used people to slay one of Jesus' servants called Antipas, all right? And so I wanted to draw this to your attention because you have to be aware that a whole lot of government systems and so forth, the systems of this world are under the control of the devil. They're under the control of the evil one. They're not just men making some decisions. Some of the decisions that some of the leaders are making, dear God, they're stupid decisions. You sometimes wonder, dear God, I'm a blind person, and no disrespect to the blind, but you know, it's just a phrase of saying, I'm blind so-and-so could have made a better call than that. And that's no disrespect to you if you can't see or you're blind. I pray for your healing in Jesus' name. But what I'm saying is some of the decisions that these politicians and so forth make, you sometimes wonder, how in the world could they have made such a stupid decision? How could so-called seemingly intelligent people make such stupid decisions? Well, you understand it when you understand that they are actually being influenced and deceived by evil spirits, rulers of the darkness of this world, you see, principalities, princes, demonic princes over a particular location, over polities, over particular locations. And they aim to rule in governments and run governments, because if they run the governments, they control the spiritual atmosphere of the city, or they control the spiritual atmosphere of the nation, except, glory to God, except for intercessors. Now, if you have intercessors praying, intercessors can cause the angels of God to be at work, pulling down those demonic forces, pulling down those evil spirits and principalities that are trying to control things. Glory to God. And those intercessors can help to pray that the will of God be done in the nations. We need intercessors to continually be on the wall praying. My brothers and my sisters, some people say, well, I don't know what my call is. Listen, take the first part of the call. Accept the call to pray. Ask God to use you to pray and intercede. God can use you, and the Spirit of God can flow through you in prayer to go against these evil spirits that attempt to control the atmosphere of the nations and the atmosphere of our nation. And listen, don't be naive. These demonic spirits are working around the clock, trying to literally control and deceive whole nations, and try and control and deceive the atmosphere of the churches and all. There are churches that are being caught away in deception because these demonic spirits are at work trying to deceive and trying to manipulate and trying to cause men to fall to the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. And that's how many people follow these demonic spirits, because they see things that their flesh wants. They see that they can have all the money they want. They see that they can have all the woman, and sometimes with women, all kind of perverseness. They see that they can have fame and fortune, you see. And sadly, because people, that's what they run after, thinking that that is the height of life, they get deceived by these demonic spirits. You better be very careful and make sure that your life is about Jesus Christ and that your life is about pleasing Him and not trying to make yourself out to be some great one. Because in the end, all that will really matter is whether or not you lived under the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Now, let's go on here because our time will wrap up on us in a bit. Notice here, Jesus, after talking concerning and commending his faithful servant Antipas for standing for him even to death, he says to this church here at Pergamos, he said, "But I have a few things against thee, because thou hast them there that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed unto idols, and to commit fornication." So that's the first thing the master said he had against them. All right? And we're going to talk about the doctrine of Balaam in a few minutes. And then he said, "So hast thou also them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans." Now notice back in chapter 2 there and verse number 6, he told the church of Ephesus, "Thou hast them there that hatest, but this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans." He calls it the deeds of the Nicolaitans. But notice here in verse 15 to this church at Pergamos, he says, "So hast thou also them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which thing I hate." Then he says those words again, "Repent." I was talking with a friend of mine just recently and told her about a mutual friend of ours who went on a 40-day fast to seek the Lord. And when he came out of that 40-day fast, our believers were standing around because he had influence, you know, and people looked to him for spiritual leadership. And when he came out of that 40-day fast, he said the word of the Lord was repent. Now, what is interesting is that Jesus himself, when he came preaching repentance. John the Baptist, who foreran Jesus, came preaching repentance. It seems like the church today has gotten away a whole lot from the doctrine of repentance. Paul calls it a doctrine, you see, in the book of Hebrews, the 6th chapter. The word repent means to change one's mind. It means to actually turn around and go another direction. In other words, to repent doesn't mean to just tell God you're sorry for doing something. To repent means to turn from it, to change your thinking about it, you know. And Jesus, interestingly enough, when he appeared to John and gave him these messages to these churches, he would tell them, after rebuking them and telling them what he had, where he had a problem with them, he would tell them, repent. Notice Jesus didn't say, "But I know y'all have them problem and I understand, don't worry about it." Jesus told them, repent. And I believe he's telling all of us the very same thing today. If we're doing things that he doesn't like, if we're doing things that are contrary to his word, the word of the Lord to all of us is repent. Change your mind about it. Turn from it. Turn around from it. Don't do it. Turn from it. And that's what he said to this church. Repent. Now, let me say something else here. I pray that this message finds itself into the hands of pastors, because it is very interesting here that the master is actually talking to pastors here. So not only were these churches being told to repent, to turn around, but the Lord was talking to pastors, because listen, we ought to be responsible enough when it comes to dealing with God's people to literally let them know the truth. To not compromise, to not say, "Oh, we'll just teach some things, but there's some things being in touch because we don't want to lose members." Or, "Oh, we'll just teach some things, but we don't want to touch certain things because we may lose our biggest contributors, our biggest financial contributors." We are responsible under the head of the church to let people know the ways of God and to let people know things that are not according to the ways of God. We are responsible for when we see error being taught in or being shared, or when we see error come about, we are responsible for teaching the people the truth of God's word and going against error. and going against the spirit of error. All right? And so we cannot allow these things to grow in our congregations, thinking, oh, they'll just go away and so forth. Because listen, if you leave it alone, it will spread. It'll be like leaven, a little leaven that leavens the whole lump. It'll spread if we don't deal with various issues that we need to deal with as pastors. And the Lord Jesus is holding us accountable. Notice that these messages were given to the pastors. He's holding us accountable. All right? And so be bold and be strong and realize that God got you. And realize that if you're preaching and you're teaching the truth of God's word, God will stand with you. And of course, we don't do this to try and hurt people. We're not trying to condemn people. We're not trying to hurt people. But we have to let people know the truth. That's the point. All right? So let's read on and then we'll come back here. He says, repent or else I will come unto thee quickly and will fight against them, those who are holding to these doctrines, the doctrine of Balaam, and the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, quickly, and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. He that had an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh, will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that had that received it. All right, let's go back here and look a minute, please, at the doctrine of Balaam. If you remember, and you can go in your Bibles to Numbers chapters 20, well, you can start from 19, but start from like around chapters 22 and into chapter 25, the story of Balaam. Balaam was a false prophet who prophesied for gain or prophesied for money. Interestingly enough, apparently some of the things what he said and some of the things he did came to pass. So much so that when Balak, who was an evil king, decided that he wanted to curse the children of Israel, he wanted them stopped, he wanted to be able to defeat them, he went looking for Balaam, and he offered Balaam money to come and curse the children of Israel. But Balaam couldn't curse him. God won't let him curse him. And Balaam tried several times to curse him, and God won't let him curse him. Instead, God made sure he blessed him. that you need to read that. That's funny. And God made sure he blessed him. And he told Balak, he said, I can't curse who God has blessed. Now, some of you who being prophesied to, saying people waking witchcraft on you, you need to lay hold to that. You need to lay hold to that truth. People can't curse who God has blessed. You can try all day long. Witches can try all day long to say they're going to curse a man or a woman of God. As long as that man or woman of God standing with Jesus Christ, the devil can't do a thing to them. Can't. The Bible said, he that is born of God keepeth himself. 1 John 5:18. And the wicked one toucheth him not. Glory to God. The wicked one toucheth him not. So you don't need to be afraid. You just need to stay under in the secret place of the Most High. You'll abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Praise the Lord. No evil will befall you. No plague will come nigh your dwelling. In Jesus' name. Now notice here now. Balaam couldn't curse him. God won't let him. So what he did was he taught Balak how to get God to go against him. How to get God to go against his own people. He said, what you got to do, get your women to seduce the Israelite men. Get your women to seduce, these were the Moabites. Get your women to seduce the Israelite men, you see. Pull them into fornication. Pull them into sex outside the boundary of marriage. And get them into idol worship. If you will influence them to worship idols, he said, and influence them to fornicate, meaning to have sex out of the boundary of marriage. And in particular here, he's talking about with the Moabitish women. He said, God won't protect them because they'll be in sin. And sure enough, you read the story, that's exactly what happened. The children, the men of Israel, lusted after those Moabitish women. They fell into fornication. They went into idol worship and began to worship those idols of those people. And the people were able to, now God couldn't protect them, you see. And you had a problem with your enemies. Well, let me talk to you here a minute. Because how does that fit into this context here? When he said you have them there that are teaching the doctrine of Balaam. It is interesting to me that I one time spoke with a young man, and he said to me, he said, well, you know, you shouldn't be having sex out of marriage, that is, unless you are engaged. And I said to him, where do you learn that? Where you see that in the Bible? Where you see that? And he said, in 1 Corinthians 7, where Paul said, let them do what they will, they sin it not. So I told him, I said, that's not what that said. And of course, the whole context of it was Paul was talking to people saying, listen, if you want to get married, go ahead and get married once you're past the age where you could get married. Once you're at that age, he said, go ahead and get married. He said, he didn't say, let them do what they will, they sin it not. He said, let them do what they will, they sin it not. Let them marry. You see, God is against fornication, period. He's against sex outside of marriage. I don't care what excuse you try to bring up for it. God is against sex outside the boundary of marriage. You may say, oh, but God understands. God understands that he's against sex outside the boundary of marriage. All right? He's against it. You will never talk him into your right to do it. He's against it. It is sin. It is wrong. And his word to you is repent. Now, I whether you believe it or not, our time is just about gone, but I want to read one scripture to you. And you will see here that God doesn't play with these kinds of things. Watch this in Revelation chapter 21. I read this verse to you earlier, but I want to read it to you again. And look at what he says about the fornicators. He says, but the faithful, Revelation 21:8, but the faithful, those who were so afraid of what people would think that they won't live for God, and unbelieving, and the abominable, that abominable here speaks of people who are involved in things that God detests, like homosexuality, lesbianism. God detests those things. They're the abominable, okay? And then you have, and murderers, and whoremongers. Whoremongers is another name for fornicators. That's what it means. It means a fornicator, all right? And it says, whoremongers, and sorcerers, and idolaters, and all liars shall have their part where? In the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. No person practicing sex outside the boundary of marriage is going to heaven. Did you hear me? You can't play around with these things. You cannot practice living out of the boundary of God's word and still think you have heaven made. All right, so our time is gone, but I encourage you in Jesus' name, let's all take an inspection of ourselves. Let's all examine ourselves, and let's examine ourselves in the light of God's word. These messages to these churches are just as relevant now as they were then. God doesn't play around with these things. And we're coming to the end. We're coming to the time when Jesus is going to catch his church away. And we're coming to the time when he's going to come back after the 7-year tribulation. And he's going to sit as the great judge. And he's going to sit as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And then we're going to come to that white throne judgment. And you don't want to play around with your life. You do not want to play around and miss the rapture. And you do not want to play around and end up in the lake that burns with fire and with brimstone. We have to get back to preaching and teaching on holy living. We have to get back to preaching and teaching on the importance of living right. We cannot play games with this because Jesus is coming and because people's eternal souls are lying in the balance. Well, my time is up, but listen to me. If you don't know Jesus as your Lord and your Savior, just pray with me and mean it with all your heart, and he will come into your life. And if you're a person who says, well, I'm saved, but I've been living that kind of life, playing around in sex outside of marriage, then it's time for you to repent. It's time for you to turn around and turn away from it and ask God to help you. And he will help you if you ask him to help you. All right? But pray this prayer with me and mean it from your heart. Say, Father in heaven, I believe Jesus is your son. I believe he died for me and shed his blood to wash away my sins. Right now, I receive Jesus Christ as my Lord and my Savior. I believe He's alive, and I invite Him to live in my heart. In Jesus' name, I confess all of my sins to you now. Please forgive me for every time I've missed your mark. Wash me from sin in the precious blood of Jesus, I pray. And Father, I pray you seal me and fill me with your Holy Spirit and help me to live for you from this day on. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Remember, Jesus Christ is Lord and divine love flows.
So glad that you joined us for this time in God's Word today. And we want you please to go ahead, if you want to see other videos coming to you from Jesus Christ Center Ministries International, subscribe to this particular page. Like us on Facebook at Jesus CCMI. And by the way, if you have prayer requests, please email us. Our email address will be on the screen in just a moment. Email us and let us know how we can pray for you. Until we meet together again around God's Word, remember, Jesus Christ is Lord and divine love flows.